welcome you to tonight's meeting of the pension committee. I'd particularly like to welcome those who do travel a little way to be here with us tonight. Trina, you're sitting next to John, who's travelled all the way from St Helens, so welcome here. And also, particularly Norman, I know Norman travels from Knowsley Council. And we also have Patrick.
I'm looking here.
Anyway, welcome everybody. It's a pleasure to have you all here. Good attendance tonight, so I really appreciate that. I don't consider we'll be here all night. It's not a complicated agenda that we have before us tonight. Obviously, I encourage anyone to ask questions as the meeting progresses. First of all, are there any declarations of interest?
Can I just say, do you mean first chair? I'm a member of the pension fund, so.
And I always do have an interest in the way that I'm a member of the pension fund.
I'm just a job.
Okay. I'm meeting chair and a member of the fund. That's a lot of money on the fund.
Until then, yeah, and the board. Okay, thank you very much for doing that. We have before us the minutes of the previous meeting, held on the 15th of September. For those who'd like to have a chance to read them in full. Is everybody happy that there are accurate records of the meeting? Okay, I'll just sign those. And matters arising from those minutes. There is one item actually I'd just like to draw the attention to. Actually, item 37 of those minutes. It talks about the annual employers' conference, which a date for our diary is next Thursday at Entry Race Course. And I'd just like a guide just to run us through the arrangements for that, please.
Thank you, Chair. Yes, reported at the September Pensions Committee was the date for the annual employers conference for the pension fund, which is next Thursday, 27th of November. At that time, we didn't actually have agreed with the speakers. I can let you know now that we have confirmed a number of officers who will do their usual report. We have the pleasure of listening to Mr. Wallach, Yvonne and myself. But we also have some external speakers. The actuary, Tommy Lubin, will be giving an industry update and covering the information about cost management. And also we have the pleasure of a representative from the Office of the Pensions Ombudsman will actually take about 45 minutes of the agenda covering employers' discretionary policies for the local pension scheme. With the introduction of the new pension scheme as of the 1st of April, all employers have had to update and create new employers' discretionary policies. So the pensions ombudsman will, that's in the slides, go through some examples of where, if you don't get the wording quite correct in your discretionary policies, what can go wrong. He's also going to actually take you through the new website as well. So it should be an interesting afternoon. The event will start at 10 o'clock at Entry Race Course, and it is scheduled to finish at 1 o'clock and lunch will be provided. I encourage your attendance. Thank you very much.
Has anyone got any questions? I, for one, have not attended that event myself, so I'm looking forward to going. And anyone who can make it? Anyone got any questions of Guy over that before we move on? Okay, thank you for that. Okay, on to agenda item 3, which is the local recruitment pension update, and Yvonne has heard a report for us on that.
This report informs members of the consultation on the second round of the draft governance regulations, which take account of common proceedings in response to the dual consultation, which was covered at our members' committee meeting. These regs also incorporate the first draft of the provisions on the cost management process. The Consultation documents can be accessed from the link provided within paragraph 2.4 of the report. The broad changes from the earlier draft provisions are listed in paragraph 2.5 to 2.6, with the key amendments for the local pension boards being that elected members can sit on the pension board as an employer rep, with the proviso that any elected member or officer of the admin authority who is responsible for the discharge of the LGPS cannot be a member of the board. Establishments and procedures of the board are to be determined locally, and there is no longer the requirement for employer and member reps to form the majority. A new provision has been added to ensure that the pension board has the resource to carry out its role. The Shadow Board has produced draft guidance to assist admin authorities to establish the boards and provide strategic direction to aid consistency across the LGPS while retaining the flexibility within the regulations. It is the intention that the actual regulations will come into force from the 1st of January next year, and the boards need to be implemented by the 1st of April next year. Section 2.9 covers the cost management proposals, which share some of the pension risks between employers and members. The proposals require the Secretary of State to appoint a scheme actuary to carry out valuations and apply two different cost control measures. The two measures are the internal cost management process and the Treasury process. The internal process will be monitored by the Scheme Advisory Board and set the future service rates at 19.5%, with member contributions yielding 6.5% and the employer cost cap is 13%. The aim is to ensure the future service costs remain within 1% of the 19.5%, and the Scheme Advisory Board will make recommendations on changes to the scheme to achieve this. The Treasury process monitors the value of benefits in a new scheme based on model-driven data and requires action to rebalance costs if they move 2% above or below this cap. Member-driven costs will be included in the mechanism, but financially-driven costs will not. Members' costs include improvements in life expectancy and pay increases, but the financial costs include the impacts of investment returns and changes in financial assumptions. Past service deficits are outside the cost management process, but the Shadow Board has commenced a project with PwC to consider solutions on how to manage deficits. Paragraph 3.2 highlights that as the Shadow Board's guidance is not prescriptive, there is a risk that inconsistencies in governance across the LGPS will continue. Paragraph 8 refers to the increasing cost of the LGPS confirms that the proposals on cost management will help to protect employers against the rising cost of longevity. The recommendation is that members of the people have to take any questions, Chair.
Thank you,
Bob. Thanks, Bob. Yvonne, at the top of 2.11, it mentions several working parties. This would be fair for that.
Responded to the first draft consultation in June, and we feel that the revised provisions actually reflect the comments that we made, so there's nothing else contentious in it. And the other part of the regulation relates to the cost management. As we were at a conference last week with SIFA, an annual conference, and Bob Holloway was there, and he actually, cost management was on the agenda. He didn't cover it at all, and just basically said there's only about 5 people in the country that actually understand the cost management process. So I think it's the best place to even that to be at before reading that trivial thing to comment on that.
Okay,
lots of
good questions
then, sir. Oh, good, Jeff. Yvonne, when you were on 2.5, you mentioned some changes. I think you said that certain groups would no longer have to be the majority. Can you explain what that change is?
Yes, the original regulations said that the employer and the member representatives have to form the majority of the board because it's allowable for all the members to be on the pension board. That's actually silent in this draft of the regulation saying that the members and the employees have to form the majority. That's no longer there.
Thank you.
Okay, more questions for there is a recommendation. We note the contents of the report. Is everyone happy?
Should we do that?
Okay, the following agenda item again is to be presented by Yvonne, which is a natural follow-up item regarding the creation of the new pension board. So, again, if Yvonne presents that to us, thank you.
Thank you, Chair. This report provides an update on the requirement for rural council to establish a local pension board in accordance with the LGPS regulations and the scheme advisory board's guidance. Over the last year, members have been updated on the need to introduce a pension board to assist the pension committee in ensuring compliance with legislation and the pensions regulators' requirements. The purpose of the board is to raise the standard of management and administration and to increase employer and member representation. Paragraph 2.3 covers the Public Service Pension Act, which outlines the general requirements for board membership and prescribes that members must not have a conflict of interest, they must be equal numbers of employer and member representatives, and each member must have an appropriate level of knowledge and understanding in relation to the scheme, local policy, and overall pension legislation. Paragraph 2.5 confirms that the LGPS regulations, as drafted, require each admin authority to put a pension board in place and require the terms of reference and appointment to the board to be agreed by the admin authority. Paragraph 2.7 contains a link to the draft guidance, and paragraph 2.8 outlines the best practices for the creation of the pension board. The guidance provides options rather than being prescriptive, and useful information, including a list of key elements that should be considered as part of the terms of reference, considerations for the appointment and selection process, terms of office, conflicts of interest, voting rights, quorum, allowances and budgets. It clarifies that other members may still be part of the pension board, although not mentioned in the latest draft regulations, and highlights the legal requirements relating to knowledge and understanding. Paragraph 3 covers the key stages in implementing Wirral's pension board, with the requirement to consider the structure, which must be representative of the range of employers and members in the fund, develop terms of reference and internal and external reporting channels, with the terms identifying clear distinctions between the role of the committee and the board. We need to look at how we invite nominations for seats on the pension board and the selection and appointment procedures, which must be by an open and transparent process. We need to determine a rolling training programme and develop the content and format of reporting packs. The admin authority must have approved the composition and terms of reference of the board by April, but but it doesn't have to be fully operational until the 1st of July. As we've been giving periods of grace due to the late publication of the fund of the final regs and guidance. Section 4 highlights the risk of non-compliance with the regulations due to the amount of work required and the challenging timescales from implement the board by the 1st of April. And Section 9 confirms that any costs associated with the pension board will be treated as an administration cost and charged to the fund. The recommendation is to note the contents of the report and the requirements for the Council to establish a pension board by the 1st of April 2015, and that members authorise officers to work with the admin authority to establish the pension board within the issued guidelines. Details will be reported to the January Pensions Committee. Thank you, Chair. Happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much, Chair. In relation to the comments in 2.5 and 3.1, how many members of the authority would be required to accommodate this? Do we have a figure in mind, or is it an open one? The second part of that question is, as it states in the report in the previous one, will members of this particular select committee be part of that? It states you've got to be very good decision making.
It's actually mandatory to have two employer reps and two member reps as well. But due to the size of mid-sized pension funds and the number of employers within the fund, we feel that it is perhaps more representative to have a larger number of employers to reflect the different employer bases that we have, statutory employers, community admission bodies, and academies. And we need to be thinking about the correct selection of employees and members within the fund. And your second point, yeah, that's correct. If you are actually engaged with the discharge of the management of the LGPS as members of this pension committee, will not be allowed to sit on the pension board, because that will be seen as a conflict of interest, as the role of the pension board is actually to assist the committee in administering the scheme, but also to scrutinise the decisions that the committee has made.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Chair. Okay,
any other questions for Ron on this report?
Comprehensive report, Chair, and those recommendations.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we're happy to go with that recommendation then. Thank you. Thanks, Yvonne. The next agenda item is to do with authorised signatures, and it's fairly comprehensive and detailed, but perhaps if we could ask Donna to just talk us through that.
Yes, thank you, Chair. The reason for bringing the report is that one of the previous authorised signatories, Paddy Dowdall, has left the fund and he's been replaced by Linda DeForge. So that is reflected under Section 2 with the current and revised signatories. In addition, under 2.6, we've taken the opportunity to expand the number of officers able to exercise power of attorney on behalf of MPF and Rural Council, just to make sure that officers are available should that be required. Thank you, Chair.
The question I asked at the briefing, but have the number of signatories stayed the same, roughly, say, over the last 3 years, or have we got more? And I can understand why you need a comfortable amount, because if you read 3.1, there's a financial risk of settlements are delayed transactions and settlement trades aren't made. So have we got the same amount, is there more or less?
Yes, thank you, Councillor. The overall number has probably remained fairly unchanged, but the balance has moved from fewer rural signatories to more fund signatories, which just reflects the availability of rural directors to be available to sign.
Okay.
Sorry, just to note, in terms of that time, our director of resources, Vivian Quayle, has resigned to the post. So we will be making progress to cover that post in due course. But at this moment in time, certainly we have enough cover within the administering authority and the secretary. So if there's any difficulty with the name, I just need to remove these reports.
Just on that, in response to that comment, we've reduced the numbers. Nothing against what we've got before. We have a fixed number. We need a set amount of members of staff who are able to sign off the checks at every one particular time. Obviously, people can sign it and move. How easily are we to replace them and make sure it's done in a smooth fashion?
In terms of staff leaving, we can very quickly take away access to systems. In terms of adding authorised signatories, it is only done with the authority of this committee. So with 5 committee meetings each year, there is a small delay before we can add names, but it's manageable.
Thank you.
Sorry, Paul, I've got to ask the question again then about the numbers, because there is a financial risk if checks aren't in place, and doesn't the chair have delegated powers to give an on to another secretary? In other words, why wait until January for the next committee meeting if somebody leaves in the meantime? Sorry, I'm asking.
I don't know the answer to that. I'm sure there will be flexibility for something to be done in conjunction with the chair should there be an urgent need. I'm not sure if this is a requirement that we've put ourselves on or whether it's something that's under council standing orders.
Okay. Normally, it certainly would be the officer to carry out that function. Members would want to ordinarily take care of operational decisions. Signing stops us. Certainly, it's important to speak our constitution to always be the officer.
Is that the question you asked, Harry?
I asked whether we have to wait till January. These are very blooming times, and officers tend to go for one reason or another. And what I'm saying is, does the chair have a delegated power? Why wait until January for the next committee meeting? Well, if the chair has delegated powers to appoint somebody, why not?
It's not for me to be added to the checkbook. It's not good for me to do that.
No, delegated powers to give a nod to the new signatory.
Through you, Chair, just to start that. We'll check the constitutional aspects of it, if there's any concerns around that. But I think, hopefully, in terms of the numbers that we have, when officers at that time will probably be given 3 months' notice anyway. So hopefully we'll have enough to cover at any moment in time.
Thank you.
Next, we'll do questions there.
Thank you for the
input from the officers. So there is a recommendation there, and is everybody happy to approve the recommendation?
Thank you.
Okay, agenda item 6 is a supplementary item with the report that's attached. So again, I'll ask Peter to talk me to that.
Yes, thank you, Chair. This report provides members with a summary of monitoring training events attended by officers and details of costs of hospitality received over the 12-month period from October 13 through to September 14. It's important that the fund is able to monitor officers' activities, and this report is brought to committee for them to consider. The recommendation is that members note the report.
No report, yes.
Okay, thank you for that. It's quite a detailed report. And, okay, thank you. Can I just add the fact that we as members need to be aware of our responsibilities as well as members of this committee, so perhaps we can reflect on that. The next item on the agenda is the LGC Investment Conference. And again, Peter is going to give us some information on that.
Yes, thank you, Chair. This is held next year on the 26th and 27th February. Lois described as a Chester conference. It is actually several miles outside Chester, down at Carlton Park. It's an investment conference, and there are some useful workshops which enable those attending the conference to engage in a more detailed way in relation to some of the investment side. And in addition, there's some topical subjects, governance arrangements, shared services. So in view of its proximity to the pension fund, we've generally suggested that it's open to all members of the community, but clearly it's for this committee to determine attendance and to approve that.
Any questions on that? Is this something that the members of this committee have attended in the past? Any questions about that particular event? If it's open to all members, that's the recommendation. If we're happy just to approve it as it is, then we can do so. Happy to approve it as it is, the recommendation. Okay. We're going to go on to agenda item 8, which has an appendix attached, which is exempt. However, I'd like to ask you to consider the minutes of the Investment Monitoring Working Party, which we're required to have. The minutes in question are the 11th of September and the 9th of October. And for those who are in attendance, I'm happy to approve the minutes. There was an amendment to the minutes, which was pointed out to us by a member of the general public. Quite rightly so, with George one in attendance at a particular meeting in question, so happy to make that amendment. But other than that, is those who are in attendance happy to approve the minutes as they stand?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you. So the next agenda item is actually introduction to an exempt item, which is item number 10. So I'd like to thank the members of the public for their attendance at tonight's meeting. Under section 100A, 4, the local government act, the public be excluded from the meeting during consideration of the following items of business on the grounds. Therefore, the lengthy disclosure of exempt information as defined by the government paragraphs part 1. Scheme 12A, as amended to that act. So, can I thank you for your attendance tonight? Go to the exempt item for the agenda. So happy to propose and second that.
Thank you,
Jim. Thank you.